Now, it's 30 years since the first transmission of Monty Python's Flying Circus. So, now on BBC Radio 4, here's something completely different.
And now we present the first episode of a new radio drama series, The Death of Mary, Queen of Scots. Part 1, The Beginning.
You are Mary, Queen of Scots.
I think the BBC were unbelievably brave. I don't think they knew quite what they were commissioning.
Python was, on the whole, you know, it was hard labour, but it was a labour of love, and we did enjoy it, and we did enjoy all these characters. And if I was that, I can see people getting a bit sort of excited and enthusiastic about it, and I suppose it's just one step to obsession.
I always think that Python had no effect whatsoever, you know. It sort of, in some ways, it just sort of stultified people.
This constant mixture of complete silliness with this sort of intellectual abstraction. I don't know if anybody else in the world who could do it other than sort of deranged public school boys who've been through Oxford and Cambridge.
Hello, I'm Carol Cleveland, and in 1969, I guess I was what you might call a glamour stooge. I'd been working with people like Ronnie Corbett, Ronnie Barker, and Spike Milligan, when a rather odd bunch of fellows showed some interest in having me in their new comedy series. When I first met up with them, I have to admit that I didn't really think that the show was much of a goer. Know what I mean? Oh, it was certainly unusual. And in comparison, everything that had gone before in terms of television comedy seemed fairly sane and straightforward. Something which John Cleese had discovered when he was working on The Frost Report.
Well, all the sketches had to be squeezed into this very rigid format. They had to have a sort of a particular type of beginning, and they certainly had to have a punchline at the end. And it was all you could do to restrain producers from putting a musical sting on the end so that you'd say, it's not my rabbit, it's a fish. Da 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 dee, like TW3 used to use. And the other thing was the content of the sketches themselves. If you got at all way out, the director on The Frost Report, who was a lovely man, a man I'm enormously fond of, called Jimmy Gilbert, who produced a very good show, Jimmy would say, yes, but they won't understand it in Bradford. And we didn't know whether he was right or not. He probably was for The Frost Report. It probably wasn't mass audience stuff. But one was still frustrated because you wanted to try it and see whether it would work.
About the only person to break free of the mould was Spike Milligan. And having worked alongside Spike, I have to say that the experience was almost traumatic. I never knew what the man would do next. But Spike's surreal humour, and that of the goons, planted weird and wonderful seeds in the fertile imaginations of nascent Pythons Michael Palin and Terry Jones.
The goon shows for me were a breakthrough in the sense that I discovered my own sort of comedy heroes in the goons, and my parents had listened to the usual sort of Much Binding in the Marsh, Take It From Here, The Army Game, they'd watched those sort of things and really enjoyed. But the goons came along and they didn't know what it was. I mean, my father used to come in when I was listening to the goons and think the radio set had broken down. He thought, well, you know, what's happened here? You know, like, oh, yeah, oh, these noises going. I said, no, it's all right. Honestly, it's all right. It's a comedy show. I said it without seeming very convinced. And so, you know, in a sense, I owed a lot to the goons because it just encouraged me. It brought something out of me, which was, again, a humour that came from absolutely from within, from a gut feeling. It wasn't derived from the way someone else had done it. It wasn't witty. It wasn't particularly clever. It was just some downright funny bone stuff.
I think all of us were sort of fans of the Goon Show when we were at school. I must say, I very much felt that the goons had done something with radio. They'd taken the medium of radio and kind of explored it. They'd sort of exploded it, if you like. And they'd shown that you could use radio for flights of the imagination that were really sublime.
The difference between them and us was they were Cambridge lads, you know, cerebral comics, really.
Harry Secombe.
We were grammar school lads, apart from Michael Benteen, who was an Old Etonian. So our humour came from the Variety Theatre more than anything else. And I was very excited. I thought, well, you know, they had taken up where we left off on television, whereas we were always on radio. And it was, you know, inventive television.
I think, I mean, we were grammar school boys as well. I think it was only just the sort of, you know, Python always had the furniture of intellectualism around it. So, you know, we're talking about Goethe or Proust, but I don't know, I haven't read Proust, but we're making jokes about it. You know, we know what we ought to have read, even if we haven't read it.
Michael Palin and Terry Jones had been at Oxford, while John Cleese, Graham Chapman and Eric Idle had been at Cambridge. American Terry Gilliam, on the other hand, had rather surprisingly blown in from Medicine Lake, Minnesota, via California and London. Gilliam was to provide the distinctive animation for Python, whilst John and Graham had formed one writing partnership and Michael and Terry Jones another. How the whole strange team was assembled is the stuff of Python legend, but I think it's fair to say that Barry Took had a big hand in the dealings.
I was sitting with Marty Feldman, and he had been working with John Cleese and Graham Chapman, and I'd been working with Michael Palin and Terry Jones at Thames. And I said as a joke, I'll put my two Oxford chaps against your two Cambridge chaps. Right? And we laughed, and that was the end of that. We finished our meal and parted, and we went off different ways. And as I walked home, I thought, hey, that's not a bad idea. Why if we don't put, if we put those two sets of people together, the way they think at the university is quite different. And that impressed me. I thought, well, that's fascinating that that there is quite a difference in the way they approach humour. And I thought that the contact between the two, the rubbing of one against the other, the rough surface, might produce a spark that would be funny.
Barry kind of greased the tracks because he knew how the BBC ran. And not only did he kind of make the right introductions and get us to the right people, but he also acted as sort of godfather to the project in those very early stages when we didn't know what it was going to be called, for example. So the BBC started calling it Barry Took's Flying Circus, and we liked the Flying Circus bit, and then we argued for about 6 weeks as to whose Flying Circus it was, and came up with Monty Python.
Not this record!
I think we did consciously attempt to produce something fresh, something that was our own, and in a sense satire had already sort of burnt itself out. It had become a joke. Even the satirists sort of thought satire was a joke word by the sort of mid-60s. It had achieved a breakthrough in the early 60s because David Frost had brought university comedians down, and university comedians generally sort of were satirical at that time. So it opened a few doors. But already, as far as I can remember, we had been like cross-pollinated with Ronnie's and people like that, and Marty Feldman, people who hadn't come from university, weren't particularly interested in satirical stuff at all. And I think we certainly wouldn't regard ourselves as being a satirical show, or, you know, overtly satirical. Of course there was satire, but it was going to be heavy, clumsy, head-on if we wanted it to. You know, what was most important was that it was, you know, it was fresh and it was not like anything anyone else had ever done.
Today on Silly Noises, our two teams are the Bournemouth and District Amateur Gynecologists, who take on our visitors today from Goole in Yorkshire, the Humber and District Catholic River Wideners Club. And it's Bournemouth's turn to choose the first subject, Bournemouth.
Clay pigeon shooting, please.
No, Goole?
History?
Yes, well done, Goole. And so Goole got a point ahead in Silly Noises this week, and here's history. What famous 19th century foreign minister made this noise when you pushed him?
Nick, 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 nick.
Lord Aberdeen?
Yes, 3 points. And now, Bournemouth?
Yes?
Wrong. The answer was a pederast. No points there. Goole, your second history question. What European treaty was signed to the sound of this?
The Franco-Prussian Alliance of 1821?
Yes, indeed, no mistaking that. Now, Bournemouth, you ready?
Yes.
No bad luck, rather a difficult one, no points. And so, with Goole leading by 7-0, we're going to suddenly stop the game.
I don't think that anybody was really trying to put the boot in. I mean, somebody said something rather nice about me. He said, you don't really put the boot in, but you're deadly accurate with the pom-pom slipper.
Neil Innes, known to some as the Seventh Python, and whose musical contributions are definitely part of Python history,